Oh, youth, the strength of it, the faith of it, the imagination of it. To me, she was not an old rattletrap carting about the world a lot of coal for a freight. To me, she was the endeavor, the test, the trial of life. I think of her with pleasure, with affection, with regret, as you would think of someone dead you have loved. I shall never forget her. Pass the bottle. One night, when tied to the mast, as I explained, we were pumping on, deafened with the wind, and without spirit enough in us to wish ourselves dead, a heavy sea crashed aboard and swept clean over us. As soon as I got my breath, I shouted, as in duty bound, "Keep on, boys!" When suddenly I felt something hard floating on deck strike the calf of my leg. I made a grab at it and missed. It was so dark we could not see each other's faces within a foot, you understand? After that thump, the ship kept quiet for a while, and the thing, whatever it was, struck my leg again. This time I caught it, and it was a saucepan. At first, being stupid with fatigue and thinking of nothing but the pumps, I did not understand what I had in my hand. Suddenly it dawned upon me, and I shouted, "Boys, the house on deck is gone. Leave this and let's go look for the cook." There was a deck house forward which contained the galley, the cook's berth, and the quarters of the crew. As we had expected for days to see it swept away, the hands had been ordered to sleep in the cabin, the only safe place in the ship. The steward, Abraham, however, persisted in clinging to his berth, stupidly, like a mule, from sheer fright, I believe, like an animal that won't leave a stable, falling in an earthquake. So we went to look for him. It was chancing death, since once out of our lashings we were as exposed as if on a raft, but we went. The house was shattered as if a shell had exploded inside. Most of it had gone overboard. Stove, men's quarters, and their property, all was gone. But two posts, holding a portion of the bulkhead to which Abraham's bunk was attached, remained as if by a miracle. We groped in the ruins and came upon this, and there he was, sitting in his bunk, surrounded by foam and wreckage, jabbering cheerfully to himself. He was out of his mind, completely and forever mad. With this sudden shock, coming upon the fag end of his endurance, we snatched him up, lugged him aft, and pitched him head first down the cabin companion. You understand there was no time to carry him down with infinite precautions and wait to see how he got on. Those below would pick him up at the bottom of the stairs all right. We were in a hurry to go back to the pumps. That business could not wait. A bad leak is an inhuman thing. One would think that the sole purpose of that fiendish gale had been to make a lunatic of that poor devil of a mulatto. It eased before morning. The next day the sky cleared, and as the sea went down, the leak took up. When it came to bending a fresh set of sails, the crew demanded to put back, and really there was nothing else to do. Boats gone, deck swept clean, cabin gutted, men without a stitch but what they stood in, stores spoiled, ships strained, we put her head for home, and, would you believe it, the wind came east, right in our teeth. It blew fresh. It blew continuously. We had to beat up every inch of the way. But she did not leak so badly, the water keeping comparatively smooth. 2 hours pumping in every four is no joke, but it kept her afloat as far as Falmouth. The good people there live on casualties of the sea, and no doubt were glad to see us. A hungry crowd of shipwrights sharpened their chisels at the sight of that carcass of a ship, and by Jove, they had pretty pickings off us before they were done. I fancy the owner was already in a tight place. There were delays. Then it was decided to take part of the cargo out and caulk her topsides. This was done. The repairs finished. Cargo reshipped. A new crew came on board. And we went out for Bangkok. At the end of a week, we were back again. The crew said they weren't going to Bangkok. 150 days passage. In a something hooker that wanted pumping 8 hours out of the 24. And the nautical papers inserted again the little paragraph, Judea, bark, Tyne to Bangkok, coals, put back to Falmouth, leaky, and with crew refusing duty. There were more delays, more tinkering. The owner came down for a day and said she was as right as a little fiddle. Poor old Captain Beard looked like the ghost of a Gordy skipper through the worry and humiliation of it. Remember, he was 60, and it was his first command. Mahon said it was a foolish business and would end badly. I loved the ship more than ever and wanted awfully to get to Bangkok. To Bangkok. Magic name. Blessed name. Mesopotamia wasn't a patch on it. I remember I was 20, and it was my first second mate's billet, and the East was waiting for me. We went out and anchored in the outer roads with a fresh crew, the third. She leaked worse than ever. It was as if those confounded shipwrights had actually made a hole in her. This time, we did not even go outside. The crew simply refused to man the windlass. They tossed us back to the inner harbor, and we became a fixture, a feature, an institution of the place. People pointed us out to visitors as that air bark that's going to Bangkok has been here 6 months, put back 3 times. On holidays, the small boys pulling about in boats would hail, Judea, ahoy! And if a head showed above the rail, shouted, where are you bound to, Bangkok? And jeered. We were only 3 on board. The poor old skipper mooned in the cabin. Mahon undertook the cooking, and unexpectedly developed all of a Frenchman's genius for preparing nice little messes. I looked languidly after the rigging. We became citizens of Falmouth. Every shopkeeper knew us. At the barber's or tobacconist's, they asked familiarly, do you think you will ever get to Bangkok? Meantime, the owner, the underwriters, and the charterers squabbled amongst themselves in London, and our pay went on, past the bottle. It was horrid. Morally, it was worse than pumping for life. It seemed as though we had been forgotten by the world, belonged to nobody, would get nowhere. It seemed that, as if bewitched, we would have to live forever and ever in that inner harbor, a derision and a byword to generations of longshore loafers and dishonest boatmen. I obtained 3 months' pay and a 5 days' leave and made a rush for London. It took me a day to get there and pretty well another to come back, but 3 months' pay went all the same. I don't know what I did with it. I went to a music hall, I believe, lunched, dined, and supped in a swell place in Regent Street, and was back to time, with nothing but a complete set of Byron's works and a new railway rug to show for 3 months' work. The boatman who pulled me off to the ship said, hello, I thought you had left the old thing. She will never get to Bangkok. That's all you know about it, I said scornfully. But I didn't like the prophecy at all. Suddenly, a man, some kind of agent to somebody, appeared with full powers. He had grog blossoms all over his face, an indomitable energy, and was a jolly soul. We leaped into life again. A hulk came alongside, took our cargo, and then we went into dry dock to get our copper stripped. No wonder she leaked. The poor thing, strained beyond endurance by the gale, had, as if in disgust, spat out all the oakum of her lower seams. She was recaulked, new coppered, and made as tight as a bottle. We went back to the hulk and reshipped our cargo. Then on a fine moonlit night, all the rats left the ship. We had been infested with them. They had destroyed our sails, consumed more stores than the crew, affably shared our beds and our dangers, and now, when the ship was made seaworthy, concluded to clear out. I called Mahon to enjoy the spectacle. Rat after rat appeared on our rail, took a last look over his shoulder, and leaped with a hollow thud into the empty hulk. We tried to count them, but soon lost the tale. Mahon said, "Well, well, don't talk to me about the intelligence of rats. They ought to have left before, when we had that narrow squeak from foundering. There you have the proof of how silly is the superstition about them. They leave a good ship for an old rotten hulk where there is nothing to eat, too. The fools, I don't believe they know what is safe or what is good for them any more than you or I." And after some more talk, we agreed that the wisdom of rats had been grossly overrated, being, in fact, no greater than that of men. The story of the ship was known by this all up the channel from Land's End to the Forelands, and we could get no crew on the south coast. They sent us one all, complete, from Liverpool, and we left once for Bangkok. We had fair breezes, smooth water, right into the tropics, and the old Judea lumbered along in the sunshine. When we went 8 knots, everything cracked aloft, and we tied our caps to our heads. But mostly she strolled on at the rate of 3 miles an hour. What could you expect? She was tired, that old ship. Her youth was where mine is, where yours is. You fellows who listen to this yarn, and what friend would throw your years and your weariness in your face? We didn't grumble at her. To us aft, at least, it seemed as though we had been born in her, reared in her, had lived in her for ages, had never known any other ship. I would just as soon have abused the old village church at home for not being a cathedral. And for me, there was also my youth to make me patient. There was all the East before me, and all life, and the thought that I had been tried in that ship and had come out pretty well. And I thought of men of old who, centuries ago, went that road in ships that sailed no better to the land of palms and spices and yellow sands and of brown nations ruled by kings more cruel than Nero the Roman and more splendid than Solomon the Jew. The old bark lumbered on, heavy with her age and the burden of her cargo. While I lived the life of youth and ignorance and hope, she lumbered on through an interminable procession of days, and the fresh gilding flashed back at the setting sun, seemed to cry out over the darkening sea, the words painted on her stern, "Judea, London, do or die." Then we entered the Indian Ocean and steered northerly for Java Head. The winds were light. Weeks slipped by. She crawled on, do or die, and people at home began to think of posting us as overdue. One Saturday evening, I was being off duty. The men asked me to give them an extra bucket of water or so for washing clothes. As I did not wish to screw on the fresh water pump so late, I went forward whistling, and with a key in my hand, unlocked the forepeak scuttle, intending to serve the water out of a spare tank we kept there. The smell down below was as unexpected as it was frightful. One would have thought that hundreds of paraffin lamps had been flaring and smoking in that hole for days. I was glad to get out. The man with me coughed and said, "Funny smell, sir." I answered negligently, "It's good for the health, they say, and walked aft. The first thing I did was to put my head down the square of the midship ventilator. As I lifted the lid, a visible breath, something like a thin fog, a puff of faint haze, rose from the opening. The ascending air was hot and had a heavy, sooty, paraffiny smell. I gave one sniff and put down the lid gently. It was no use choking myself. The cargo was on fire. Next day, she began to smoke in earnest. You see, it was to be expected, for though the coal was of a safe kind, that cargo had been so handled, so broken up with handling, that it looked more like smithy coal than anything else. Then it had been wetted more than once. It rained all the time we were taking it back from the hulk, and now, with this long passage, it got heated, and there was another case of spontaneous combustion. The captain called us into the cabin. He had a chart spread on the table and looked unhappy. He said, "The coast of West Australia is near, but I mean to proceed to our destination. It is the hurricane month, too, but we will just keep her head for Bangkok and fight the fire. No more putting back anywhere if we all get roasted. We will try to first stifle this air damn combustion by want of air." We tried. We battened down everything, and still she smoked. The smoke kept coming out through imperceptible crevices. It forced itself through bulkheads and covers. It oozed here and there and everywhere in slender threads, in an invisible film, in an incomprehensible manner. It made its way into the cabin, into the forecastle. It poisoned the sheltered places on the deck. It could be sniffed as high as the main yard. It was clear that if the smoke came out, the air came in. This was disheartening. This combustion refused to be stifled. We resolved to try water and took the hatches off. Enormous volumes of smoke, whitish, yellowish, thick, greasy, misty, choking, ascending as high as the trucks. All hands cleared aft. Then the poisonous cloud blew away, and we went back to work in a smoke that was no thicker now than that of an ordinary factory chimney. We rigged the force pump, got the hose along, and by it burst. Well, it was as old as the ship, a prehistoric hose and past repair. Then we pumped with the feeble head pump, drew water with buckets, and in this way managed in time to pour lots of Indian Ocean into the main hatch. The bright stream flashed in sunshine, fell into a layer of white crawling smoke, and vanished on the black surface of coal. Steam ascended, mingling with the smoke. We poured salt water as into a barrel without a bottom. It was our fate to pump in that ship, to pump out of her, to pump into her, and after keeping water out of her, to save ourselves from being drowned, we frantically poured water into her to save ourselves from being burnt. And she crawled on, do or die, and the serene weather. The sky was a miracle of purity, a miracle of azure. The sea was polished, was blue, was pellucid, was sparkling like a precious stone, extending on all sides, all round to the horizon, as if the whole terrestrial globe had been one jewel, one colossal sapphire, a single gem fashioned into a planet. And on the luster of the great calm waters, the Judea glided imperceptibly, enveloped in languid and unclean vapors, in a lazy cloud that drifted to leeward, light and slow, a pestiferous cloud defiling the splendor of sea and sky. All this time, of course, we saw no fire. The cargo smoldered at the bottom somewhere. Once Mahon, as we were working side by side, said to me with a queer smile, Now if she would only spring a tidy leak, like that time when we first left the channel. It would put a stopper on this fire, wouldn't it? I remarked irrelevantly. Do you remember the rats? We fought the fire and sailed the ship too, as carefully as though nothing had been the matter. The steward cooked and attended on us. Of the other 12 men, 8 worked while 4 rested. Everyone took his turn, captain included. There was equality, and if not exactly fraternity, then a good deal of feeling. Sometimes a man, as he dashed a bucket full of water down the hatchway, would yell out, "Hurrah for Bangkok!" and the rest laughed. But generally we were taciturn and serious and thirsty. Oh, how thirsty! And we had to be careful with the water, strict allowance. The ship smoked, the sun blazed, past the bottle. We tried everything. We even made an attempt to dig down to the fire. No good, of course. No man could remain more than a minute below. Mahon, who went first, fainted there, and the man who went to fetch him out did likewise. We lugged them out on deck. Then I leaped down to show how easily it could be done. They had learned wisdom by that time and contented themselves by fishing for me with a chain hook tied to a broom handle, I believe. I did not offer to go and fetch up my shovel, which was left down below. Things began to look bad. We put the long boat into the water. The second boat was ready to swing out. We had also another, a 14-foot thing, on davits aft, where it was quite safe. Then, behold, the smoke suddenly decreased. We redoubled our efforts to flood the bottom of the ship. In 2 days, there was no smoke at all. Everybody was on the broad grin. This was on a Friday. On Saturday, no work, but sailing the ship, of course, was done. The men washed their clothes and their faces for the first time in a fortnight and had a special dinner given them. They spoke of spontaneous combustion with contempt and implied they were the boys to put out combustions. Somehow we all felt as though we each had inherited a large fortune. But a beastly smell of burning hung about the ship. Captain Beard had hollow eyes and sunken cheeks. I had never noticed so much before how twisted and bowed he was. He and Mahon prowled soberly about hatches and ventilators, sniffing. It struck me suddenly, poor Mahon was a very, very old chap. As to me, I was as pleased and proud as though I had helped to win a great naval battle. Oh, youth!